Oh. The first lesson is from the 11th chapter of Jeremiah. It was the Lord who made it known to me, and I knew. Then you showed me their evil deeds. But I was like a gentle lamb led to the slaughter, and I did not know it was against me that they devised schemes, saying, "Let us destroy the tree with its fruit. Let us cut him off from the land of the living, so that his name will no longer be remembered. But you, O Lord of hosts, who judge righteously, who try the heart and the mind, let me see your retribution upon them, for to you I have committed my cause." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be
to God. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your craving that are at war within you? You want something and do not have it, so you commit murder. You covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not ask. You do not ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly in order to spend what you get on your pleasures. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and the devil will flee from you. Draw near to God, and God will draw near to you. Cleanse your hearts, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks
be to God.
Gathered that therein lies the purpose and points to it at Jesus' feet is the table for which his body and blood is given to those gathered when we share the Holy Communion. Not front and center, but front and to the side is the baptismal font. Its placement showing the importance, the beginning of the journey of faith. Not front and center, but front and to the other side, to my dismay, is this pulpit, rendering whatever I say subservient to these other focal points. We all knew before that sermons and pastors are peripheral, and so the arrangement of the space helps to enforce that. It isn't only the space, but the next time you enter into a store or a business, the gathering place of the organization that you're part of, even your own home, pay attention to what the layout wants you to know about what is important. As you develop this spatial awareness, considering what is in the front, in the middle, toward the back, you will also begin to notice that how communities, cultures, and societies are designed, and how that design communicates what people think is important, what they value, and who they think matters. In today's gospel reading, Jesus finds himself contending with a world where spatial design communicates worth, and what the consequences of our architectures are, and how we might consider a different configuration. Jesus shares with his disciples once again that the Son of Man is to be betrayed and killed and rise again. Still, although Jesus has been sharing such thoughts from time to time, they don't understand what he means by these words. They hesitate to ask him to clarify. The Son of Man, after all, was a figure believed to be sent from God to judge the world, to enact cosmic justice, and exact the vengeance of God. It doesn't make any sense within the tradition that the one sent to judge the world should be judged, that the person picked out to determine the righteousness of the nations would himself be killed off. Of course, the one worthy to make such judgments wouldn't be treated as worthless. Part of why this doesn't make any sense to the disciples is that they themselves are caught up in a world designed and arranged in a certain way. Their world is ordered to center the powerful, the rich, the honorable, and the pious. They assume that the Son of Man is to be a central figure exhibiting these kinds of qualities, not one who is cast out of the circle of importance, expelled out of the center. So it is that the disciples desire to be among those the society is centered. They cannot see the sense of the judge being judged because they fancy themselves in proximity to power and influence. Well, Jesus has overheard their quarrel on the road, and he asks the disciples what it was all about. They are embarrassed and ashamed because they had been arguing about which of them was the greatest. So they keep to themselves the particulars of their conversation. Jesus responds with a spatial awareness object lesson. He takes a little child, and he places the child in the middle of them all. And taking the child in his arms, presumably also in the middle of them all, he says, whoever wants to be first must be last and servant of all. He says, whoever welcomes a child welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. This is an unexpected thing to do. We tend to glorify childhood. But in this time, being a child meant having no standing at all, no worth, no importance, until they grew old enough to work, to marry, and to have kids, and thus continue on the family line. When Jesus sets the child among them, he centers one who is of little account in their cultural life. He brings into the middle one who is among the last and least of his society, and fixes their eyes on the child as the focal point. Joining the statuses, the insignificant child in the middle, Jesus declares, whoever welcomes a child welcomes him. He throws his lot in with a worthless one, thus giving the disciples with a new spatial awareness, a new place to look for meaning, for greatness, for importance. Jesus gives the disciples a new center around which to organize their lives, the inconsequential, the valueless, and the suffering and rejected. With Jesus joining the child in the middle, the disciples can begin to understand from the spatial awareness object lesson his comments about the Son of Man. The one sent by God to judge will not be a central figure, a middle or front person, a focal point, a person of power and prestige, but one who suffers and dies, who is rejected and cast out. Not only this, if they wish to be great, they will throw their lot in with the child, with the rejected. Thus following Jesus means that they will have to recenter their lives around something, around someone, much different than they assumed. The design of the kingdom of God is oriented towards such like this child, such like one sent from God, but sent away packing. The arrangement of the space of the kingdom of God communicates that it is welcome for the worthless, that it values the devalued, that it brings into the middle the worthwhile, puts at the front the forgotten, the left out, and left for dead. As followers of Jesus, disciples, in this day and age, we are called to reconfigure our lives according to this pattern of the kingdom of God. We are called to center the outcast and the suffering, to value the vulnerable, to consider who Jesus is placing in our midst now, who Jesus stands with in the middle, to redirect our attention and concern. Jesus is giving us a new architecture for our world, one that does not cater to the privileged and powerful, but the design of which sharpens our focus upon those who, like Jesus, are judged, crucified, and demonized today. We are challenged to see that welcome of such as these is welcome of Jesus and welcome of the one who sent him. We are summoned to live out this call and challenge in a society that organizes its space in a much different way. This calling and challenge and summons is what Bonhoeffer, weeks before his arrest, called an experience of incomparable value that we have for once learned to see the great events of world history from below, from the perspective of the outcasts, the suspects, the maltreated, the powerless, the oppressed and reviled, in short, from the perspective of the suffering. He continues to say, if only during this time bitterness and envy have not grown at the heart, that we come to see matters great and small, happiness and misfortune, strength and weakness with new eyes, that our sense for greatness, humanness, justice, and mercy have grown clearer, freer, more incorruptible. That we learn indeed that personal suffering is a more useful key, a more fruitful principle than personal happiness for exploring the meaning of the world in contemplation and action. Direct your attention to the front and center. The design and arrangement of this space, the focal point, is not just Jesus communicating that our purpose and mission here is about Jesus. It is Jesus crucified. From the moment we walk into the sanctuary, the one who was judged, blamed, suffered, and killed is placed in our midst. And this placement forms us to be people who arrange our lives around that center. To arrange our lives around that center when we leave this space, seeing the world through new eyes. In your individual vocations, in your collective power of voice, vote, in the way that you make and spend your money, in your congregational leadership and participation, in each of the arenas of your life, this spatial awareness comes to be how you live out the promises of God. Attentiveness to those who suffer, mindful of the maligned, working for the well-being and welcome of those deemed to be worthless, all shaping us to challenge what our culture puts at the front and in the middle. Joining Jesus in the new middle, where he stands with a child, welcoming us into a different center and purpose, creating a new world where all they are beloved and valued. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried.
He descended to the dead.
On the third day he rose again.
He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Made children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of community, we pray for the church around the world. Unite us in your love for you. Help us overcome our divisions, that we are encouraged to work together for your sake. Guide all leaders of the church and seminarians, especially Lars Anderson, now in his internship year. Lord, in your mercy. God of creation, we pray for this hurting earth. Awaken us a new desire to care for this world and empower us to support agencies, organizations, and individual efforts to heal our environment. Lord, in your mercy. God of cooperation, we pray for nations of the world embroiled in conflict. Inspire leaders to listen to each other and work towards peaceful solutions to disagreements. Protect the vulnerable, especially children, who cannot find safety in their homes or country. Lord, in your mercy. God of comfort, we pray for all who live with mental or physical illness. Help them find appropriate care. Bring healing and wholeness when the path forward seems bleak. We pray especially for Philip Hedges, Norma Wittig, Sonny Poling, Gary Williams, Grant Bowen, Katie Roper, Carrie Birdseye Erickson, Rochelle Anderson, Al Johnson, Jamie Desimone, Ann Holacek, Clyde Erickson, Sue Malley, Patty Pearson, Helene Williams, Roger Erickson, Joan Sandino, Beverly Hoppy, and those we name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. God of compassion, we pray for the young people of this congregation. Renew in us your call to welcome the children in our midst. As they grow, strengthen their faith and our commitment to them. Lord, in your mercy. God of consolation, we give you thanks for our loved ones who have died and pray for all who grieve today. Shine your grace on all your saints. Lord, in your mercy.
Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
We may be seated. So we have a couple of announcements to share with you this day. As Julie shared with us in worship last week, Chum has had almost 30% increase in costs for many of the goods that they need for helping those in our community. And so please take the time to read through the paragraph about what Chum's needs are and to be generous. disaster response regarding the Afghan humanitarian crisis. And so Lutheran Disaster Response, along with Lutheran Immigration and Refugee Service, is looking to do some work in settling Afghan refugees in the United States. And so any support that you throw their way for this cause will go toward helping accompany Afghan families to our shores. Okay, are there any other announcements from you all? Well, beginning last week, we embarked on a journey of processing this experience of the pandemic, even as we are still in it. We began our worship service with a time of lament, of voicing the grief, loss, and anger that we have been carrying for this year and a half. Well, now we would like to make room, space, for the voice and the stories of those among us who have experienced the pandemic in a unique way. Today we welcome Tracy Holochek to share her experience of the pandemic, her time as a healthcare worker, giving space for her to voice her story and the grief and hope therein. So Tracy, come on. You want me to move up? School over?
Good morning. Forgive me if I stumble through this or my voice quivers. I'm not a public speaker. And I find it difficult to condense my story in an appropriate amount of time without droning on and on. First off, as Pastor Jeff introduced me, my name is Tracy Holochek. My family and I are members of the church. Pastor Jeff and I have been talking back and forth by email for a while. I was emailing him with concerns I had and anger about the pandemic and what it was doing to me personally, to our United States and how it was becoming divided, and I was angry about a lot of things. So to give you a little background about me, I'm a registered nurse and I have been for the past 17 years. I have spent all of that time in the hospital setting between Essentia Health Duluth and Community Memorial Hospital in Cloquet. At the time the first cases of COVID-19 showed up in the United States, with Washington being the first state, that was in January of 2019. At that time, I was working in the emergency room at Cloquet. And Cloquet is a very small hospital, it's state-run. It's got only 18 beds for the general population, and there's only 9 beds in the ER where I worked. The first time that we had our confirmed COVID patients was in late February or early March of 2019. We do believe that we saw some people prior to that, a cluster of people that probably had COVID-19, but it wasn't in our awareness yet to be testing. We did not supply it yet either. One of the first frustrations that I and my coworkers experienced was the lack of direction that we were receiving. There was so much mixed information coming out of the CDC that our plans for personal protective equipment changed almost daily at a point. We had a binder this big, and every day a new update was put in from the Minnesota Department of Health of how we should be protecting ourselves. And as this was a novel virus, we weren't sure how it was spreading. Initially, we were told to wear these masks that many people wear. And these masks don't protect you from others. As you probably know, they create a barrier so that if you're sick, you don't spread it. And that's how it works with everyone wearing masks. We didn't know that it wouldn't protect us at this point. Then the next change came that said we needed the N95 respirators, and we didn't have those at my hospital. So we continued with these masks, and then they said maybe we should put on goggles. So we did that. Because of all this misinformation and lack of clarity on what we were supposed to do, so oftentimes we would send patients home because we couldn't do anything for them. We didn't have any of the treatments like the convalescent plasma and the antiviral. They weren't recommended yet. We didn't have those monoclonal antibodies. So people would go home, and then a week later find out they had COVID, and they would unknowingly spread it to their families, and we would unknowingly have it. At one point in my hospital, over half the staff was out either on quarantine because they had been exposed or because they were sick with COVID. That created its own problems with short staffing, people being exhausted, frustrated, doing double after double, trying to keep up. In that ER that I worked in at the time, we sometimes, it would be only 25 and at the most 40 patients a day that we would see in the whole day. And all of a sudden, the number started to double and people were getting sicker and sicker, and we didn't have the resources to take care of them. So we were sending them to Duluth. Forgive me while I find my spot. We moved on to half-face respirators, face shields, gowns, double gloving. It was exhausting. If you had a patient who had COVID, you were stuck in that room and you couldn't leave. Other nurses would have to bring you supplies, so a lot of time was wasted. And you got behind on your work because you had to remain in that room. And it was physically exhausting. At one point, they took our masks and they locked them up to prevent people from getting more than one of these a day. These are supposed to be one use per patient, not meant to be worn all day long. That in itself was so belittling that we're tasked with taking care of people's lives, but we couldn't be trusted with masks, and the morale started to lower from there. Next, the next frustration, and there's several, and this is not to gain pity, it's just what I experienced and what my coworkers experienced. In February at that time, I found out that I had cancer. It was skin cancer, it was a melanoma, and it was successfully removed. It was on my back, but that added on to the layer of fear. Next was the political nature of the vaccine, of the virus itself, and people were taking sides. Many politicians and many of their supporters turned masking and the virus itself into a political issue. They called it a hoax. Medical staff across the country were having people tell them that we were making this up. I even worked with one doctor who at the time was refusing to follow the precautions. And when I asked him, "Aren't you afraid of bringing this home to your family?" And he said, "If it's my time to die, it's my time to die." It was beyond frustrating. At a time that our own staff should be united, we were divided. And it was political. We were also told as nurses and healthcare workers that we signed up for this. And there were many times before work, I would be so terrified, I would have an anxiety attack and start crying because I thought, is this the day that I'm going to catch it? Is this the day I'm going to bring this home to my then 14-year-old daughter and my husband? I started to hate going to work. At the time, our then president even made an accusation that I quoted here was gutting to all of us in healthcare. This, for me and for many of my coworkers, was a turning point. I didn't feel supported, appreciated, and I was afraid all the time. If our then president was implying to the entire world that we were stealing, who was there to have our backs? I personally was afraid to go anywhere in my scrubs because stories started to come out in the news about nurses being attacked. Nurses, two stories that I recall were nurses that had gone out in their scrubs to a gas station or a convenience store. They hadn't even been to work yet. They were on their way, and one was sprayed with gasoline, and the other was attacked with Windex and Lysol, and was sprayed in her face and all over her clothes. We were no longer safe in the hospital, and now we weren't safe outside the hospital. I also felt terrified, as I said, of bringing this home to my family. I was stripped down in the entryway. We had garbage bags and Lysol, and I was afraid to go near them. We have a very small house, so there was not a good way to social distance. It was around October of 2020 now, that I no longer felt like I could make the drive to Cloquet. I wanted to be closer to home. I thought going back to Ascension Health in Duluth would be the right decision. They have so much more money and so many available resources. Before I took the position, I had a lot of questions about their PPE or the personal protective equipment. Would we have respirators? What were they doing? We were told they had the N95 masks, which, if anyone's worn them, they're horrible. But to wear them for 13 hours is truly exhausting. But I felt relieved that I would be safe. I was given two masks when I started in October, and you had to alternate using those two. These masks are meant to be used for 2 weeks at the most, and with one patient. I used those two masks for 3 months. They were misshapen, they no longer held their seal. So I was terrified. They developed a cleaning system, first with peroxide masks and then ultraviolet light that were experimental. And when you got that mask back from cleaning, it had this distinct smell. And many of us developed coughs, which I think were from the chemical treatments. I developed sores on my skin, on my nose that required treatment, on my ears. Profuse sweating from constant running. And at one point, we were given glue, skin glue, to put on to keep the mask in place. My move to Ascension turned out to be a nightmare for me. Things were so much worse, just due to the sheer volume of patients coming in with COVID, needing rapid intubations and breathing tubes. ICU beds and COVID treatments, the length of time they took, it was staggering. And I'd gone from a hospital that saw 25 to 40 patients a day to myself seeing 25 patients in a shift and not being able to keep up. At one point, we started testing everyone that came in for a test or seemed to meet criteria. I did end up leaving, but by the time I left, I had days where every patient I tested was positive. And you questioned everything about what you had done Most of the people that we saw at that time that were positive were from nursing homes and had other health issues. However, I started seeing patients in their 30s that were dying, that we had no information that they had an underlying health condition. And the media was reporting that you don't need to worry about it if you're under this age or you're healthy. And then there was the other side of the media causing a lot of fear. And they were both misleading. These patients that came in typically were people that weren't masking. And many of them came in and needed almost immediate intubation. And they only had a few seconds to make a call to a family member, and that was often the last time they spoke with them, as they passed away within 2 weeks. One of the hardest parts was seeing this replay itself over and over and over again, and having patients come in that would refuse to wear a mask and talk about the infringement on their rights. And I started to become so angry. I was taught in nursing school, I went to this Alaska, and under the Benedictine traditions, we were told to look at every patient in the eyes and see Jesus in them, and to treat them as if you were treating Jesus without judgment. And I started to lose that. I was judging and I was angry, and I emailed Pastor Jeff a lot. I felt bad about who I was becoming and how angry I was at patients, and it was affecting my care for them. I was exasperated by what seemed to be the willful ignorance of many people. I'll try to wrap this up here. I'm not going long. In December of 2020, I had a patient who was COVID positive accidentally spit in my eye. I had my goggles on, but the way I was leaning over him, it got beneath my goggles. And I was so full of fear. I was sent home immediately to quarantine for 2 weeks. And I had to come in for multiple COVID tests. And thank God I was negative. I was actually supposed to get the vaccine the following morning, and now I couldn't get it. By the time I was supposed to come back to work in January, it was January 1st when I became incredibly ill. And I woke up, and I couldn't sit up. My husband had to pull me out of bed, and I couldn't walk. I didn't know what was happening. Once again, I was so afraid. So I was hospitalized through January 21st on 3 separate occasions, trying to figure out what was wrong. They found some things in my back, but it didn't explain the amount of pain I was in. I kept in contact with my manager and said, I can't come back yet. I can't walk unassisted, so I couldn't take care of anyone. Finally, one diagnosis was that I had C. difficile, and if you're not familiar with that, it's an intestinal infection. It's very contagious and it's miserable. So I was treated manager asked me to resign. They didn't want to fire me. And the reason for that was so I could come back to work for them. So I wrote my letter of resignation on February 3rd. This was the first time in my life that I didn't have a job, and I was sick. I was unable to collect unemployment because I had resigned. So there was nothing I could do. I started to be able to walk about 3 feet again after getting some injections in my back. I still couldn't work. This was such a financial blow to my family that I had to cash out the little bit of money that I had saved in my 401k for my retirement to pay my bills. Everything I worked for seemed to be falling apart. Physically and mentally, I was probably at my lowest. So I was out of work for 8 months. And over the 8 months, I slowly gained some strength and more mobility. I'm still having pain, and so I can't get back to the hospital setting, nor do I ever want to. This pandemic and the response that the public had and that the politicians had and the division it caused, I just didn't want to be a nurse anymore. I had loved my job, and I had gone into it to heal people. And now, I was losing all empathy for people that chose to put themselves in risky situations. At this time as well, my stepdaughter got COVID, and she is diabetic. So that was a huge stress in our family. I swear it's not meant to be pretty. And my mother-in-law, who is now 93. No one knows her real age. We know she's over 93. She got it too, in the nursing home. She survived amazingly. But all these things kept piling on and piling on, and there just was no reprieve. And I prayed a lot, and I didn't feel heard. And I messaged Pastor Jeff and asked him to pray, because I couldn't take it anymore. I felt like a failure as a nurse, because it became my identity over 17 years. I'm a nurse, that's who I was. Aside from being a mother, that's who I was first. So losing this, and losing my love for it, was like losing me. During that time, I received some gift cards from the church for groceries and gas. And when I opened those, I sobbed like a baby. My husband didn't want to accept them because he's too proud. But I said, we need this help right now. So he agreed. He wanted to re-gift it to someone else who needed it more, and I said, we need it. That brings us up to now. Several vaccines are on the market. Many people are vaccinated. My entire family is vaccinated. Thought this was the light at the end of the tunnel. But understandably, many people are very afraid of this vaccine. A lot of it because of misinformation that's being spread. And I'm not here to promote the vaccine. I do think that needs to be a personal choice, but I think it's a choice that needs to be made for the greater good. But now we have this variant, and that sealed my fate. I wasn't ever going to go back to work in the hospital setting. mountain because I thought I would feel even more depressed. Working daily with people that had Alzheimer's or dementia, or illnesses that they just couldn't live at home anymore. But what I found is that that's where I'm supposed to be right now. I have the time to spend with patients, and I've been able to once again look into their eyes and spend time with them and treat them like Jesus would want me to. It's coming back slowly, because when I left the hospital, my empathy tank was on empty. So once again, this isn't meant to be a sob story or a pity party. It's just the truth about the fallout of the COVID-19 pandemic from my perspective. And many healthcare workers have much worse stories than I do. In closing, thank you for listening. And thank you for masking and doing your part. Thank you for understanding the stress that healthcare workers are going through on the daily. And I hope and I pray that more people can come to understand the need to come together and stop all the political madness and taking sides, because this isn't political. It's about caring for your neighbor. And if we could all do that, we have an end to this. Thank you so much for listening this morning.
Thank you.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. So with all the choirs of angels, for the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
The power and the glory forever and ever.
Amen.
Thank you. Oh,